If you look into the momentum equation, I had already talked about rate of change of momentum is consist of two terms, unsteady term when you talk of rate of change of momentum inside the control volume, and advection term when we talked about momentum change across the control volume. So the rate of change of momentum is equals to force. Now when you talk of force, there are two types of forces. Like if you consider yourself as a fluid control volume, and what are the different types of fluid forces acting on the surface of your body? There are two type of forces which acts in your body. One is consider yourself as a fluid control volume. One is the pressure which is directly proportional to your surface area, and one is the weight which is directly proportional to your volume if you consider yourself to be a fluid. So these are the different types of body forces and the surface forces. I will not go into much detail of it as I have to quickly go to the CFD part. So this surface force and body force you can resolve into components. I would here like to point out that the way we had done the derivation, this is what is called as the conservative form of the Navier-Stokes equations. And in finite volume method, we use this form of the, we don't take the mass flux outside the derivative. And this way we ensure that the mass conservation occurs to a very large extent. When you talk of surface forces, right now I am here showing you the stresses. Let me tell you, I am showing you, okay, so rate of change of momentum is equals to force. Now this force, here what I will show you mainly are the two types of forces, two types of surface forces, which are there in all the fluid flow problems, which are like viscous forces and pressure forces. Gravitational force in many a problem, it is found to be negligible. There are other forces which comes like surface tension force if you have two-phase flow. If you have electric field, magnetic field, other forces comes into picture. But the viscous force and the pressure force are there in all the problems. So here I will discuss only these two forces. What happens if you see a surface of the control volume, the force may act in any some arbitrary direction. Here I am talking about the viscous forces. The force may act in any arbitrary direction. But here what we do is that we resolve into components. Because how we are doing balance, as you do in, let us say, engineering mechanics course, you draw a free body diagram. The force may act in any arbitrary direction, but you resolve into component and then only you balance. So in fluid mechanics also, we do the same thing. There it was solid, here it is fluid control volume. So we resolve into x component and y component. Okay, so this force is expressed in terms of fluxes as stresses. So these are vertical faces, so the surface area is delta y. These are horizontal faces, the surface area is delta x. Stress is a second order tensor, and the first subscript here represents the plane in which it is acting, and the second subscript represents the direction in which it is acting. Again, you this surface forces, it's a flux multiplied by area. When you divide by volume, you can easily get a differential term. Okay, so in conduction you get del by del x of qx, del by del y of qy. In mass conservation you get del by del x of mx, del by del x of mx plus del by del y of my. Here you are getting del by del x of sigma xx plus del by del y of sigma yx. Note that this is stress in the x direction, the x plane. This is the stress in the x direction, the y plane. This is normal stress, this is stress. So you get sigma term. In conduction you get del dot q term. Here you are getting del dot sigma term. In mass conservation you get del dot m. M mass flux is a vector. And as I said, there is a subsidiary law like Fourier law of heat conduction to convert qx into as a function of temperature. There is an expression to calculate mass flux in terms of velocity. Here also there is an expression to express this stresses in terms of velocities and pressure. Which is that law? Newton's law of viscosity. actually this derivation Professor Puranik has discussed in the previous lecture, where he has used flow kinematics and shown you that stress is directly proportional to strain rates, and strain rates is expressed in terms of velocity gradients. So that way expression between the stresses in solid, stress is directly proportional to strain, but in fluid it is directly proportional to strain rate. Finally, I'll show you the expression. This is the final expression for stress as a function of velocity gradients. Sigma xx is minus p plus 2 mu del u by del x. Sigma y minus p plus 2 mu del v by del y. Sigma xy is mu del v by del x plus del u by del y. So if you substitute the stresses in terms of velocity gradients by using subsidiary law, you get the gradients. So note that in case of mass flux and in case of momentum flux or enthalpy flux, you were having the value of the variable at the phase center. In case of conduction heat flux, and here in this case of viscous stresses, you get gradient of, in conduction it is gradient of temperature, here it is gradient of velocity. This whatever CFD I am teaching is mostly restricted to incompressible flow. That is what as a mechanical engineer most of the time we encounter, and most of you I think are mechanical engineers. So I had limited my lecture to incompressible flow. Incompressible flow, we can further simplify this equation. Let me show how I can simplify. So let me do one thing. I will take out of this two, I will take one of the del u by del x. Is that clear? And out of this two term, I will take one of the term. Which term I'll take? I'll take this term. And then I will show you that if you do a balance, it becomes zero. How I'll in the next slide. Out of the two, if I take one and do a balance and divide by volume. So if I take one means mu del u by del x plus delta x minus mu del u by del x into delta y. And out of this two term, I take this term, del v by del x at y plus delta y, del v by del x at y. If I do this, what happens? You get a term like this. This becomes del square u by del x square. This becomes del square v by del x del y. If you take del by del x common, what you get? Del u by del x plus del v by del y. Okay. So finally, I can express the stresses as this. So instead of two gradient terms or two times of a gradient, I get only one gradient for incompressible flow. Now I would say that this equation is very much similar to Fourier law of heat conduction. Heat flux acts in which direction on any surface? Normal. Gradient which is involved in the Fourier law of heat conduction is in which direction? If you talk of surface, normal direction. So in conduction, qx is del t by del x, where qx acts in vertical surfaces. Okay. So in conduction, heat flux is expressed in terms of normal gradients. Okay. This is which plane? X plane. Here it is this which plane? Y plane. Plane is x, and gradient here is expressed, this gradient is referring to, you will see that this gradient is referring to plane. And what is the direction of the plane? Normal. So here again you will see that the viscous stresses are expressed in terms of normal gradient of u velocity for x momentum equation, normal gradient of, similarly I can do for y momentum also. I can take one of this two and let us say del u by del y, and I can show that it cancels down to zero. And finally I can show that the viscous stresses in the y direction are expressed in terms of normal gradient of v velocity. Conduction heat flux, normal gradient of temperature. Viscous stresses in the x direction, normal gradient of u velocity. Viscous stresses in the y direction is a function of normal gradient of v velocity. So if you are developing code, you will not write separate subroutine for conduction flux, viscous stresses, you will write one subroutine, because for all of them you have to obtain normal gradient. So you need to realize and appreciate the commonality in the derivation. That's why I'm doing the derivation, fluid mechanics derivation. I'm not yet started CFD in true sense. These are some of the things which you should know, understand and appreciate as far as fluid mechanics is concerned. You need to understand that there are fluxes. The fluxes are at the faces. These fluxes are expressed in terms of certain dependent variables. Some of these dependent variables are expressed, some of these fluxes are dependent in terms of value of the dependent variables at the faces, like mass flux, momentum flux. They are expressed in terms of velocities, value, not gradient. There are certain other fluxes like conduction heat flux, viscous stresses, which are expressed in terms of normal gradient at faces. This realization later on helps us to understand and appreciate the discretization, finite volume method, in a better way. Okay, in conduction, this is the way you do derivation. I'm showing you in one slide. First you get, this I call as first part of the derivation. You are calculating total heat gained by conduction per unit volume. This I called as the first stage of derivation. Then when you apply Fourier law of heat conduction, which I show in the next slide, this is the Fourier law of heat conduction. Then you can finally get the double derivative. But here I again point out very specifically, my slides are little detailed because I am not giving you lecture notes, but I had written the important points wherever possible. So I have emphasized this normal gradient. Normal gradient of u velocity gives viscous stresses in the x direction, normal gradient of v velocity gives viscous stress in y direction, and normal gradient of temperature gives conduction heat fluxes. This diffusion, again, I can write all this viscous stresses and conduction heat fluxes. These are basically what is called as diffusion phenomena. If you go to the transport mechanism, they are basically occurring from random motion of the molecules. Okay, so physically, the mechanism which gives rise to conduction heat transfer or the viscous stresses are due to random motion of the molecules. So these are called as diffusion terms. So this D is general diffusion term, and this gamma phi is mu for dynamic viscosity for fluid flow and minus k for heat transfer problem, and this eta is the surface normal. I am not showing you the normal direction, the direction here. Why? I am not showing you the direction here. The reason is because this control volume I want to use for conduction. When I use for conduction, which direction the arrow points out? Surface normal, qx, qx plus dx, qy, qy plus, they are always surface normal. When I want to use this control volume for viscous forces in the x direction, then what happens? On two surface, it is normal. Vertical surface, it is normal. On horizontal surface, it is tangential. So that's why, because in a general proposition, I am not showing you the arrows, but the expression remains same. So the diffusion flux is viscous stresses. This is viscous stress in x direction. This is the viscous stress in the y direction. Note that here I had written two normal, two shear. On two surface it is normal, on two surface it is shear. And the conduction, it is always normal. Conduction heat fluxes are always normal. Here again I am not showing the arrow. So the total diffusion term, if you do a balance, it can be expressed as gamma phi del square phi. This is k del square t in case of conduction. In case of fluid flow, this becomes mu del square u for x momentum. For y momentum, it becomes mu del square v. So that was all about although diffusion mechanism give rise not only to the viscous stresses, but it also causes pressure. I am showing pressure separately for clarity. Okay, now we talk about conduction, heat transfer, viscous forces, and we talked about direction. Now let us talk about pressure. Where pressure acts on a surface? In which direction it acts? Normal. So if I want to obtain pressure force acting in each direction, on which of this surface I should draw pressure? On the surface where the pressure acts in the horizontal direction, because that will contribute the pressure force acting in the x direction. So I will only show it in the vertical faces. I am not showing in the horizontal face, it is acting, but just for derivation, for clarity, I am showing it only in the x, because here I want, my purpose is only to show force acting in the x direction. Again, what is the flux term here? What is small f here? Pressure. And when I divide by volume, note that here I get minus del p by del x, because pressure is compressive, and when I want to obtain net pressure force in the positive x direction, it becomes px minus px plus delta x, become minus del p by del x. This is the reason pressure you get as minus del p by del x. In fact, in fluid mechanics class, one of you were asking how it becomes minus del p by del x. This is the derivation for that. Similarly, if you this can be written in a vector form, del p by del x as del p dot I, where I is a unit vector in the x direction. This is the pressure force in the y direction. So this completes the derivation. This is the rate of change of x momentum per unit volume. This is the rate of change of x momentum of the fluid inside the control volume. Note that word inside. This is the rate of change of momentum flowing across the control volume. Rate of change of x momentum of the fluid flowing across the control volume. This is due to Eulerian approach. This is a temporal and this is an advective component. This is equals to viscous force in x direction. Note that all the forces are in x direction. Viscous force in the x. I am using subscript V here. Here it's not necessary because this does not contains any pressure term. The normal stresses consist of pressure terms. That's why I've used a subscript V to demarcate that this is viscous component. So this viscous, this is the diffusion term, this is the advection term, this is the unsteady term, advection term, diffusion term, and then whatever remains in CFD language we call that as source term. Here source term is pressure gradient. This is the x momentum equation. Similarly,
sir, this derivation is general or only for incompressible?
This question is, this is for incompressible or general? Right now it is for incompressible, because I had already used continuity equation as del u by del x plus del v by del y is equals to 0, when I was showing that when you balance the stresses, out of the two term one cancels down. So there I had used an approximation of an incompressible flow. So that way this is for incompressible flow. This is for y momentum, unsteady, advection, diffusion, and the source term. Similarly, this is the energy equation, rate of change of internal energy of the fluid inside the control volume, rate of change of enthalpy of the fluid across the control volume, total heat gained by conduction plus total heat gained by volumetric heat generation. Yeah. There is a mistake here, I mean, say mathematically it has not come here, it's a dot, del dot. He is asking what is this, there is a dot here. So with this I come to the end of, not this lecture session, but the derivation, because I have to complete this topic, still have 25 minutes before the tea session. But maybe I'll pause, if you have some question I'll be happy to answer. So till now I had shown you the derivation with an approach different from what Professor Puranik had shown. He had shown you a mathematical approach, I had shown you from control volume how to obtain. Why I am showing is that this understanding will help you to understand and absorb later on finite volume method, which I'll be discussing. Any question? Okay, so final equation is this. For incompressible flow, continuity, x momentum, y momentum. As I said, there is a lot of commonality you can give to the student fill in the box type of problem. This is what I commonly give. I draw some boxes and tell them write down for x momentum, y momentum and energy equation. There are two types of boxes. One small box, second a bigger box. What is coming in the small box? Advected and diffused variable. U velocity is coming in small box in x momentum, v velocity is coming in small box. And what is coming in big box? Minus del p by del x, minus del p. This small box, finally, when we talk of generality, I will denote it as phi. And this big box, I will denote as a source term, S of phi. For energy equation, actually this small box is not only temperature, it is specific heat multiplied by temperature. And the big box is volumetric heat generation. So this is your final unsteady term, advection term, diffusion term, and a source term. From here, real CFD starts. Because from fluid mechanics, we first propose that there is a lot of commonality between momentum and energy transport. We call this as a transport equation. And once we realize that commonality, then you develop one subroutine for this, one subroutine for this, and then use this for momentum as well as energy equation.
So in this energy equation,
yeah,
I guess you assume that k is a constant.
Yes.
But why do you want to pick, because probably could put in more general case.
His question is, here I have assumed that k is constant. In most of the cases, indeed this is true. However, there are cases where heat transfer become nonlinear. When I will be taking conduction theory as well as lab, okay, we have different separate lab session for that. Okay. So I will discuss it separately. But here, this is the first course in CFD, so that is why I am trying to make it simple as well as most of the commonly encountered fluid flow and heat transfer where k is constant. Okay. More complicated situations, we can take it later on. We can discuss it separately also. Okay, so as I said that this is just what I explained. This is just like a notes you can see later on, but before I end, in CFD you should also understand and appreciate not only the different terms but the fluxes which is encountered. So I'll again emphasize in different slides what are the fluxes which you encounter. Because this is what I call as small f, okay? Because this comes at the phase centers and then we need to use approximation in CFD. So what is the flux which comes when you apply law of conservation of mass? Mass flux. What is mass flux made up of? Normal velocity and the surface area. And where this mass flux comes into the expression? It not only comes in the continuity equation. This mass flux also comes in the x momentum, y momentum and energy equation. Where does it come? Because it acts like a driver. Where it acts? In the advection term. Okay, so note that this not only comes in the mass conservation, but it also comes in the x momentum, y momentum and energy equation to advect u velocity, v velocity and temperature respectively. The second flux in general is what I call as advection flux. And what is this advection flux? Advection flux is made up of two variables. One is called as advecting variable, which is like a driver, as I said earlier, mass flux. And the second is the advected variable, which are velocities and temperature, depending upon the equation. So mass flux, advection flux, and then the third flux is diffusion flux. So this fluxes comes at the phases and we need to use approximation to calculate this. Some of these fluxes are expressed in terms of value and some of them are expressed in terms of gradients. So we need appropriate approximation. Whenever we do a CFD study, especially as an let us say you are in an academic institute and you do a research, or let us suppose you are doing a PhD, normally it is suggested that you should follow standardized procedure is that you do a non-dimensional study. Okay. Later on, when we will be giving you codes in the lab session, we had made it non-dimensional. We will be doing problem not only for isothermal flow, but for forced convection, mixed convection, natural convection. So non-dimensionalization is an important concept in fluid mechanics. So we do non-dimensionalize because in any problem we have certain non-dimensional variable. Like for flow in a pipe, diameter of the pipe is taken as the non-dimensional length scale. So when you do non-dimensionalization, finally, so this is the dimensional form of the equation. When you use a characteristic length scale and a characteristic velocity scale, and you non-dimensionalize temperature for constant wall temperature in this manner and for constant heat flux in this manner, finally you get a non-dimensional equation, continuity, x momentum and y momentum equation. X momentum, momentum equation, momentum and energy equation. This I have written in a vector form. I would like to mention that if it's a forced convection problem, then you do not have temperature in the momentum equation. But if it's a mixed or a natural convection problem, you have a source term which is made up of temperature. So in forced convection, there is a one-way coupling. The flow doesn't depend upon temperature, but in mixed and natural, there is a two-way coupling. In case of forced convection, you only have Reynolds number, but in case of mixed convection, you have Grashof number. In case of natural convection, you have Rayleigh number as a non-dimensional governing parameter. When you talk of properties, there are two types of properties. One is called as the fluid property and the second is called as the flow property. Fluid property is basically thermophysical property, and the flow properties are the properties by which, let us suppose, you create movie in CFD, which are velocities, pressures, temperature. Note that not only the movie of velocity, pressures and temperature are good enough to understand fluid mechanics, because fluid mechanics is a very complicated phenomenon. So even if you watch a movie of fluid mechanics, you cannot understand it completely. You need to create different types of movies. You need to be clever enough to create different types of movies. So there is vorticity plots also, vorticity contours which we draw to understand the flow in a better manner. There are different types of flow analysis tools which we use in CFD for to get a complete, although most of the problem, let me tell you, the flow are so complex that with certainty we find difficult to say that this is the reason for happening of something. Most of the time we feel, because it's a highly very complicated, so most of the time we need to write in research paper that probably this is the reason. If you make a statement that this is the reason, reviewer will ask you that how you can, because it's most of the time, although you may show some pictures and movies for confirmation, but many times it's not confirmatory in a sense. So you need to be very conservative in your statement. These are, when I talk of from the properties, let us go to the parameters. When we talk of parameters, there are two types of parameters. One is the governing parameter, and second is what we call as the engineering parameter. What is governing parameter? When you do a non-dimensional study, your results change if you change the governing parameter. Okay. In CFD, if you look into the fluid mechanics problem, how the results change? Results change if you look into flow in a pipe, or let us say flow across a car. Why the results are changing? Because the domains are different. The shape of the domain is also different. Okay. In a non-dimensional form, when you do a non-dimensionalization, these are the common governing parameter. What I mean is that, like for flow across a aeroplane, you can study for when you vary the Reynolds number, the results changes. So this is the governing parameter. These are the parameters which you vary, which you play with and see the results. So this is like an input parameter. These are user input parameters. And this is an output parameter. Okay, so this is an input parameter. You vary this and then this results changes. This is called as engineering parameter. Non-dimensional form, this is non-dimensional form of wall shear stress. This is non-dimensional form of pressure drop. This is non-dimensional form of drag force. This is non-dimensional form of lift force. This is non-dimensional form of frequency of unsteady flow. This is non-dimensional form for heat transfer. Now, after non-dimensional, the next thing I would like to discuss is the initial and the boundary condition. Mathematicians have classified the boundary conditions into three types. That is what I will discuss here. if you, this is what type of equation, two-dimensional unsteady state heat conduction with volumetric heat generation. So there is one derivative with respect to time, so you need one condition. Two derivatives in x direction, two derivatives in y direction. So two boundary conditions in x direction, two boundary conditions in y direction. This is a governing equation in Cartesian coordinate system, so we have to take a problem in Cartesian coordinate system. So let us suppose there is a plate which is taken from a furnace. Let's say the plate is very long in the third direction, so we are using it as a dimensional. The length of the plate is L1 in x direction, L2 in y direction. Now to talk about the boundary conditions, the initial condition will be, let me take a general in the heat transfer, we have three types of boundary condition. Let us say constant wall temperature, insulated, constant heat flux and convective boundary condition. Now mathematicians have classified, okay, the initial condition is, let us suppose you took this plate from a furnace at temperature T0 and then this is subjected to this boundary condition. Mathematicians have classified the boundary conditions into three types. One called as Dirichlet, where the temperature is prescribed. Second, Neumann, where the gradient is prescribed. Third, Robin or mixed, where you have a linear combination of the temperature and the gradient. So which one is Dirichlet in of the this four wall boundary condition? Left wall is Dirichlet, temperature is prescribed. Which one is Neumann? Gradient is prescribed. Gradient is, normal gradient of temperature is 0 here. dT by dy is 0. And dT by dx is minus qw by k. So these two are Neumann. And at the top wall, when you apply q conduction is equal to q convection, you get a linear combination of the temperature and its normal gradient. This is called as Robin or mixed type of boundary condition. Now that was for a conduction problem. Now I show you one more boundary condition or initial conditions for external flow, fluid mechanics problem. Let us suppose you have a cylinder. Cylinder is a common shape which we teach in, let us say, fluid mechanics or heat transfer. This is just for simplicity we take, but this can be an aeroplane or a car also. So let us suppose we want to study free stream flow across a cylinder. So you need one boundary, inlet. As you know, in fluid mechanics, there are two types of problem. In general, we classify it of two types, external flow and internal. What is the size of the domain in case of external flow? Theoretically, when we call external flow, what do you mean by the size of the domain? Infinite domain size. But when you do simulation or when you want to create a pictures or movie of fluid mechanics, you need some fixed region. So the first question is, what should be the, where should this left wall should come? What should be the distance of this left wall of the boundary from the cylinder? This is very important question. So you have to decide the position of the domain. Where should be, so this is called as inlet. Why this is called as inlet? Because the flow is coming from, why this is called as outlet? The flow is going out from this side. So this I call as inlet boundary, this is called as outlet boundary. This is bottom boundary, this is top boundary. In CFD, many times people use software like flow across a car and they take this boundary very close to the surface of the car. Why? Because they feel that most of the action happens near to the surface of the car. Let me take the boundary very close so that the number of grid points are less and I get quick solution. But is it correct? Because you should realize that the boundary conditions which we are using, like this outlet boundary conditions which we are using, what does this boundary condition means? Del u by del x is equal to 0 means what? Flow has become fully developed. If you take this boundary very close, just behind the surface of the car, let us say, whether the flow has become fully developed? But you may ask that, how can I know? Because if the car is moving at different velocity, this distance may be different. Yes, you are right. So what you have to do? That's why I say that, go back to that Einstein statement. You have to show that you took a length, you place this boundary here, one simulation. Place this boundary here, second simulation. Place this boundary further downstream, third simulation. And if you show that this middle one, as compared to first, there is a lot of difference in the, when you say a result, there are two types of result. Qualitative result, like velocity pressure distribution. Quantitative results, like in this problem, lift force and drag force. So let us suppose the results changes a lot between this location and this location as compared to the downstream. Then this is what is called as domain length independent study or domain size independent study. So you have to take this rectangular region in such a way that with further increase in the size of this rectangular region, there is negligible change in the qualitative as well as quantitative results. On top and bottom wall, although you may feel that on the top and bottom wall it should be u is equals to u infinity, v is equals to 0, but this boundary condition is better because even if your height is small, this can give you an accurate result. This is called as a free slip boundary condition. Free slip is normal velocity is equals to 0, normal gradient of temperature velocity is equals to 0. This is a horizontal wall, so this is a normal velocity. This is a tangential velocity. Normal gradient of tangential velocity is equals to 0. Okay, now when I talked about the derivations, the Navier-Stokes equation in a general form, the non-dimensional flow properties, fluid properties.
Sir, excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I got a doubt in initial and boundary conditions.
Yeah.
When I teach this computational fluid dynamics to my students. When I talk about boundary condition, initial condition, if take a heat transfer conduction equation, from a mathematical point of view, I'm able to tell. For example, if it is one dimensional unsteady, I say that take it to two.
Please use mic.
If it is now one dimensional unsteady, from a mathematical governing equation, I'm able to tell that I needed two boundary conditions, one initial condition.
Yeah.
Like that, Navier-Stokes equation will be able to generalize.
Your question is
boundary conditions for Navier-Stokes.
Navier-Stokes equation.
Yeah. From mathematical point of view,
we can generalize.
Yeah. If you throw some light on that, it would be better, sir.
Okay. So when at appropriate slides, I will highlight that.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
His question is basically I showed the boundary condition for temperature. But the same thing can be done for Navier-Stokes equation also. Okay, now before I end this, I would like to mention that once you get the results, in software, what they do is that they call as post-processing. Because this results, first you obtain in terms of velocities, pressures and temperature. But if you show this movies, let us say movie of flow or temperature to, let us say, industry, they may not be that much interested. What they may be interested, let us say car industry may be interested, that how much petrol needs to be spent on, let us say, drag force which is exerted so that the car has to propel that drag force. So they need parameters which we call as engineering parameters. Those engineering parameters are calculated using certain integral equations, like drag force is calculated by taking the cyclic integral. There is a mistake here. This is a cyclic integral. Cyclic integral, if you take at the surface, this is the surface normal, this is the stress tensor, and this is dot I. What is stress? This sigma is a second order stress tensor. The dot product of a vector and a tensor is a vector. And that vector, if you take the ith component, it gives you drag force. And if you take the jth component, it gives you lift force. So we do the surface integral, and this is for total heat transfer. All these integrals are done at the surface. You can also obtain this using an integral approach where you take a much larger size of the domain. But here I am showing you surface integrals. Like if you have an inclined plate whose normal unit vector is expressed in terms of AI plus BJ, and this is a second order stress tensor. If you take the product of two, you get a vector. And if you take its ith component, you get the drag force. And if you take the jth component, lift force, and this is the conduction heat fluxes. If you take a flat plate and if the flow is on the both the sides, then you can obtain the viscous stresses, shear, normal stresses, and then finally calculate the drag force and lift force like this. I'm not going into the detail. I showed you the expression previous slide. You can work it out. This is quite straightforward. Okay, so with this, I had come to the end of the first lecture.